BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Your Berks Craftsman on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Hi, good evening, and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsman. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and tonight we are going to hype you up for the 69th annual Holiday
Fine Arts and Crafts Festival
at
Kutztown, Pennsylvania, the University at Michael O'Pagues
Center.
On November 3rd and November 4th.
From 5 to... Yeah, 5. five in the morning. Oh, we're starting out good. 9 to 5 and Sunday 10 to 4.
So as you can see, I have with me tonight Terry and Judy Boyer. They are the... They are the co-chairpersons of our Holiday Fine Arts and Crafts Festival, and they brought with them several of the craftsmen who will be with us at the show this year. Several of the people that are here tonight are just not only craftspersons at this fine show, but they are also on our show committee. So they work diligently and hard all year to produce this show for our craftsmen and for our patrons out there in Berks County and beyond.
And that's our goal, to have a really top quality show.
Yeah. So, Terry, why don't you tell us a little bit about the show and how it got started and what the history is to it?
Well, the show, actually, most people in Berks County would say, I thought it was at Penn State. Let me tell you, people, no, it's not at Penn State. It's at Kutztown University. And it's been there for what, the last 14 years?
Yeah, it's been there pretty long.
So we have a huge, the field house is very huge. We spread out. We have a student part of the...
Student gallery.
Student gallery. Excuse me. Thank you. I'm kind of a little tongue tied.
No, that's all right.
So we have a student gallery, which we have, this year we'll have a few high school students, but they're mostly college students that will be there. We have constant camp music going the whole time, which we have a cafe there, which you can get something to eat and enjoy the music. Butch from Acoustic Road Show is taking care of the music, so you've seen him on the BCTV
also.
Sure,
he's a big star here.
He's a big star, and just like Kay. And well, anyways, but that runs the whole time as the show is open. We're all on one floor. We have everything in art form, all the way from contemporary to very traditional, all the way from fabric to, where can I do that, glass, any realm of artwork. We have a few really nice fabric artists that are going to be there this year as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have a nice variety, but there's a lot of different vendors that do the same thing, in the same medium, let's say,
I'm going to pick on Potter because Steve's here tonight with us, so I'm picking on him. But we have many different types of pottery, which Steve can get into that.
Yeah, I think that.
So, but we have a good array of different artwork. We have, guy by the name of Friday. He has his stones on his, you can design your own jewelry.
And
it's tumbled stones, right, Cleon?
Yep.
Because Cleon's wife buys something every year from him, and he turns it into jewelry. And they're forms of art. Mm-hmm. They're absolutely stunning. Mm-hmm. Then we have all the way from silverware being turned in. What the heck?
Silverware turned into flowers.
Yeah, into flowers and lawn bugs ornaments. And beetles, but that's not what I was thinking.
The metal craft?
The metal craft, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of fun things. There's a lot of traditional. And one thing you can do with this show, and you can go and you talk to that artist, because we're the ones that are doing the work.
Yeah, and that's... See,
and most shows do not have that. And we had the opportunity that the show has wide enough aisles, and you can go and talk to that artist, and you can really know and learn about what you just might be purchasing or will be purchasing.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's the beauty of this.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, like when you learn and you talk to the artist and you ask them about their craft or what you're interested in and what, you get more drawn into it. You have a vested interest in that piece, you know, once you talk to them, you know, and stuff. Yeah. And kids are fascinated by that. Children love to hear that because they don't see that, you know.
I know there are a lot of artists at the show that do demonstrate. I am one of them, so you can come and watch different artists demonstrate to see how we actually do our work. Mm-hmm. And you were saying about children, they do get fascinated because I've done a piece that, and I try and talk to the children. Like I started doing nursery rhymes into artwork. And it's amazing, the children don't know the nursery rhymes, right. So you have to teach them.
Yeah.
You know, so it's all a matter of teaching and showing them what they're doing.
Yeah, but kids still love to work with their hands, not just not just this.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, but
yes, you get them involved.
But you get them involved.
Electronic golf.
Yes. But it's
This is the on hands thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's amazing that a lot of people don't even believe that there are people that are still doing this by their hands.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I'm saying. So when someone does talk to you about your piece or the piece of pottery, or you know, when we get to Diane about her painting and Cleon about his wood turning, I mean, everyone here does something different, and yet there will be several artists who share the same medium. You won't find two things alike there, you know. I mean, it's not like going to the store and finding it in several different sizes.
No,
you know?
Everything is one of a kind.
Yeah, and you can actually, in most cases, talk to an artist, and if you have something in mind, they might be able to, you know, work with your idea too. And most artists and craftsmen are willing to do that.
Well, so. It's custom work.
Yeah, yeah.
I know that is one of the things you can do with the artists at this show.
Yes.
This, our show, the Brandon Guild show.
Mm-hmm.
You can customize a piece as well.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us might say, oh, I have an order, but that's fine. We'll work with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'll get that done in about 3 months.
Yeah, but no, that's fine. So why don't we start down, well, tell us who your guests are here tonight.
Okay. Of course, I have Judy next to me, my sidekick. Sweetie Pie, Steve Hunter does pottery, Diane Phelan, right? Did I say that right?
Yeah.
And Cleon Garl, which he's a stable at BCTV as well. So needless to say, and actually, let's start with Cleon because you're here at the end. So we'll start with you.
Start with me, no problem. Okay.
And we'll have questions later.
Okay.
All
right. I'm a wood turner. I have a small lathe in my shop, and I love the term exotic wood. What most of the stuff I brought tonight, I will be donating to BCTV auction next month. Okay. So I'll show you the items that will be at the auction, and make sure you bid on them.
Now, what night are you on, though, Leon?
Are you
Cleon,
on Thursday
when you do
night?
No, yours is Tuesday night. You're with the hunting and fishing.
Bob Entler, whatever night he is.
Yeah.
That's when my.
I think that's Monday
that's
or Tuesday. I'm
not Thursday. It'll be Monday or Tuesday.
Yeah.
So we'll start with a bottle stopper for the wine bottles or liquor bottles. You just put that in the bottle. Like my mother-in-law says, The problem is when I drink wine, I drink the whole bottle.
So you don't need to stop.
If you don't drink the whole bottle, I sell wine stoppers. So that'll be they'll auction that off. Now for the I usually have a fish on my pen, but this year I have a deer on it. So you got to make sure that the deer hunters out there will bid on this one.
Oh, they're antlers.
So that is a twist pen with the head of a deer on it. And then for the other hunters, I have a 50 cal shell
that
I turned into a pen. It's a little twist pen.
That's unique.
And it is.
It's an actual 50 cal shell, and then it's a twist pen.
Is that new, Cleon? Is that new for you this year?
No, that's not new.
No, you do that.
Okay.
And I also have, for the deer hunters, I have a 30-06 shell, 30 cal shell, and it's a little pocket pen. It's a little twist pen, and I always have one in my pocket. You can't destroy it. It's brass and the wood. So I will have that at the auction this year. And I thought I'd do a little different this year. I have an ice cream scoop.
All right.
Different people can bid on something that's not involved with the hunting and fishing.
Right.
So we'll have an ice cream scoop also. And I have, it's called a pigtail flipper. If you look at the end, it looks like a pig's tail. So what you do is you use that on your grill and you flip vegetables, shrimp. As long as the steak isn't too big, you can flip the steak too.
Mm-hmm. But that has a sharp point.
It's very, very sharp. There's a piece of plastic on it right now, but it's very sharp. I sell a lot of those too. Okay, my new item this year is the money clip.
Oh.
Now you have to get a close-up on that.
Yeah, that's really
that's
nice.
That's whole wood.
That's a piece of wood. That's a piece of olive wood on there.
Olive.
And that's a new item this year.
That's really nice.
So I will have those at the show, our show. Now, last year, I showed a block of wood that I put together, if you remember. And I said that the white part of the wood was my wife's credit cards, which she still doesn't know I stole them.
She does
but
now.
But anyway, this year I'm going to show you the finished product.
Wow.
The white is the credit card.
The white part you see on the pen is the credit card that I cut up and glued in the wood. Different color pieces of wood. They're all natural wood. All the colors are natural. They're with the wood. So that's the finished product. That was from last year, but all I had last year was the block of wood, so this year I brought the finished product. A new one this year, you start with a piece inch by inch, and then you glue it together, and then you glue a white piece with the dark piece, and glue them all together. And then the finished product is this. This is a new pen this year, so this will be at the show also.
That's really nice, Clan.
Basically, that's about it. Like I said, I just enjoy turning wood. And if there's any questions.
Well, there's one thing I know about Clan. Okay. He has to have his shop spick and span before his wife gets home because she parks in his shop. No dirt.
It doesn't have to be spick and span, but it better be pretty clean.
It better be. Clem, what do you say? You know, it's natural, so you don't stain any of these.
No,
these
I have
natural
some,
colors.
I have some of my pieces that are stained wood, like my bottle, some bottle stoppers that I make, and my kaleidoscopes are stained wood, but I didn't bring any of that along. What they do is they take very light wood, like the piece that's right in there, the white stuff.
Okay.
And they'll dye that. And then they glue it to a big block, and then I buy the block.
And then you buy the block.
And then I turn it. So it's stained all the way through. It isn't like I have to stain it at the end.
Mm-hmm.
It's stained completely through the whole thing.
Okay.
And I sell a lot of kaleidoscopes that The kids love them, and they love the different color woods too.
Sure.
The key, it's an unusual kaleidoscope.
Right.
Because the bubbles are in a glass or plastic tube.
Yeah, and it's an oil wand.
Yeah, and you have to turn it around and look in
it. And I always joke with the kids when they're there looking at it, and they flip it over, and then I say, there's no batteries. What do you think of that? Nothing to charge.
I know. You know, and it never ceases to amaze me. Young and old alike, you know, are just fascinated by it whenever you pick it up. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like one of those things, you know.
It's one of the things you have to look in it.
Yeah.
Well, that's about all I have. Like I said, make sure you buy the stuff on and bid high because they need your money.
Yeah, support Oktoberfest. You know, support BCTV on Oktoberfest. You know, we are all great supporters of BCTV.
So here. I'm assuming the two pens at the end of the table will not be going.
No,
to
No, they won't be auctioned.
Oh, shucks.
Okay, so when you'll be able to find those though on November 3rd and 4th.
At the show.
Yes.
Very good.
On the 3rd and 4th.
Absolutely.
Okay. So I'm going to jump to Karen.
Diane,
excuse me. I thought of that thing that I had forgot earlier, gunpowder.
I'm not even going to ask.
It just dawned on me. Diane, I'm sorry. We're going to let Diane talk, and I'm going to be quiet. Go for it, Diane.
I do paintings, and most of my paintings include quilts in them. I started out being a landscape painter mostly.
Do you want to stand it up?
This is, to explain what this is, all my artwork is also made into puzzles. I've had fabric for quilters, quite a few lines of fabric. I've done books for quilters, and I've also done an art demonstration book. Right down here is where I start out with my painting. I don't know if you can focus in on the painting down below. That's where I start is with a watercolor painting, and then from the watercolor painting, I do them into cards.
No cards.
I do them into cards here too. I've also have, which I found in my studio just recently, I'll have some tapestry throws, which I didn't have for a while, so I'm going to have those at the show.
What is that, Diane?
It's like a Afghan, but it's my art on a big throw. I also found some trays that I'll have, so I'll have some new...
So you were house cleaning.
Yes, I was house cleaning this year, so I had to go through a lot of my art, and I found a lot of treasures that I used to sell.
Well, I think people might be interested in how you start out as well, because you're an artist first, that you paint the picture, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So now, do you take pictures of things
take a lot of photographs. I also sketch outside, so I go into the countryside and I do a lot of sketching. So I do that, and I'm always enamored with the seasons, so I paint by the seasons. I go through the year, and right now I'm working on a calendar, which I haven't had for a while, so I'm working on my August painting. So every month.
Will that be out for the new year?
Yeah, that'll be out next year.
For 2020. 2020.
Be for 2020.
So is that based on quilts then? A quilt for each season?
I'm doing something new. I'm doing borders with the quilts, and then the inside picture is going to be just a painting like I used to paint. I used to paint something without quilts, so that's what I'm going to be focusing on. And I did work and demonstrate one at the Kutztown Folk Festival this year. Mm-hmm. And we did have a slow festival this year because of our heat.
Yeah.
And so I got a painting that would take me a month. I got it down that whole week.
You got it
so
done
I got a lot of
week,
painting.
Yeah.
I got that done during
it's
the folk festival.
A lot of spare time.
And again, too, it was fun because the children love to come see
again,
what you do.
Right?
And they would come running over, and they absolutely loved watching me paint. So I really enjoy that.
That is such a good thing to drive that home to parents, with their kids, because they are, they are very inquisitive about anyone doing something with their hands, making something, kids just gravitate to that.
They do.
And I just don't think we give them enough of that, anymore in our lives, So.
And too, especially if you do handwork, like I hand draw everything. Yeah. So many people do computers now.
Yeah.
They do their artwork on a computer, and you can tell. I mean, to me, you can tell
it's
done on a computer.
And it doesn't have that personality.
Yeah.
I mean,
it
personality
doesn't.
Of the pieces.
So yes. I have to research perspective, I have to research color. So I do all that before I actually start drawing.
Yeah, I love talking to a painter or an artist who draws, and you know, because they talk about lighting, how important that is and the shadowing. And you don't get that from a computer.
I mean, the computer does it because
you feel very accomplished once you do that. Even a person who thinks they can't, you can.
Yeah, I love it. I feel blessed that I have something that I will always have with me, no matter what happens in my life. My art will always be there.
And the thing of it is, we don't do this just because it's a job. It's because we enjoy
it. It's a passion. It's something you have to do.
Accomplishment.
Yes,
How many pieces you have to get done in the next 2 weeks? 60-some pieces.
I did a show last week, sold 65 articles and pieces, so now I have to at least make 65 to catch up.
So it's
a busy 2 weeks.
So no wonder you were searching in your stuff, Diane, for things.
Yeah.
We do that too.
Yeah, well, I'm cleaning out my studio, and so now I'm finding all these older works that my neighbor was helping with. She said, why aren't these in print? But they were works that I did years ago, but I forgot. I will probably end up putting some of them in.
Have you noticed the advancement from the ones you found to the ones you do now?
Yeah, there's a lot more detail in my work now, a lot more. I mean, they take me, you know, months and months to paint, where before I could get a painting done in a week.
Yeah.
It doesn't happen anymore.
Except at Kutztown for 5 days.
Yeah, in Kutztown it happened, unfortunately, this year.
Sometimes simplicity, though, speaks to you, you know,
it does, in a
simple piece, you know.
I've gotten that with my houses when I first started. There's some simple house.
Yeah.
But why didn't you make any of them? Because I don't want to make any of them anymore.
I know, but, you know, sometimes it's good to go back to
our
own roots, right? You
I
know,
like
as you started.
Sometimes you don't want to go back that far.
Well, no, sometimes not. Sometimes it's not good to revisit that.
I
understand. But, you know, it's, you know, you are blessed with, you know, a gift. But here again, you know, you've taken it to the next level and keep, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll never stop. Somebody said to me about retiring. I said, you don't get to retire when you're a painter, or you do, you know, pottery.
Especially when
you're
fascinated.
Yeah, you don't get to retire, which is a good thing. Mm-hmm. So you do it forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
That's true. Definitely true.
Yeah, but it is nice to find a new way to use your art, you know, like, you know, because I didn't understand what you were saying at first about the, but it's like an afghan, that's what you're saying, your art was, you
and
know,
one time I had fabric too that quilters used in their quilts.
Yeah.
And I'm working on that too.
I was going to say
I'm
that.
I'm working on more fabric
that's
again.
A very
Within
popular.
The picture.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, but so I'm working on that. They can actually, they'll take my painting, cut it up into little pieces and make a quilt out of it. So.
That
I should have brought some fabric samples, but I didn't because I don't have a fabric line right now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have that in the future.
But you did have a fabric line
at
one
time. I worked with different companies in California, and then I worked with Elizabeth Studios in New Jersey. So I've worked about five different fabric companies.
Yeah. So you want to talk to Diane at the show because she's just a fountain of information here, you know. So quilters, you intrigue the painters, the quilters,
the whole show.
Yeah.
So it's fun to do an art show because I'm always surrounded by quilters, but when I do an art show, I'm surrounded by other artists, so I get the best of both worlds.
Yeah. And that's something we did not know.
Yeah.
Thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome.
So we'll get back to you.
Okay.
And we're going to go to Steve Hunter Stoneware on his shirt.
Yes.
It's all about branding.
Branding.
So I'm a potter, and I've been potting for about 45 years.
What kind of plants do you plant?
I just do ceramics. And so I just brought two today. And stoneware is vitrified clay, so it's waterproof. And traditionally, it was used for things like whiskey containers or molasses or things like that. And it wasn't really used as a tableware piece traditionally. But through time, it's elevated. And so these are tableware pieces. This is obviously a picture in the front. One here is a giant coffee cup. So it's nice that when you put something in it, it doesn't, you know, like if you put flowers in this and put it on the table, it wouldn't weep or anything like that. So that's really the traditional that. And if you come to our show, or when you come to our show, be lots of potters. We have a lot of redware potters.
Yeah, it's about three, I think. Three.
In our guild, there's a lot of redware. And it's a traditional redware area here in Berks County. And that redware is very similar to brick clay. Mm-hmm. And so it's always a little porous, sort of like a red flower pot. So even though there's a glaze on it, it might weep, but it has different functions.
Well, I just interject? You use the word vitrified, so maybe you want to give a definition.
So vitrified is where the clay particles melted so there's less than 3% airspace. So things that are vitrified in your house that are made out of ceramics would be your toilet doesn't leak because it's made out of vitrified china.
Oh,
have porcelain.
You're down right to the toilet.
Right to the toilet. So everybody knows what clay is. So. And then things like...
No, but that's a good...
That's good.
And then the newest push in floor tiles is porcelain.
Yeah.
And they're very hard, and they are vitrified too, so that, you don't... Here. This doesn't suck up moisture. Where older tiles are what we call softer. They're porous.
Did,
and you can tell if you turn the piece of pottery over and you put some moisture on there, if it sucks in... It's porous, if it just sits there, it's probably stoneware. And there's a color range difference. Stoneware doesn't lend itself to bright colors like red or yellow. There are some exceptions. But most of my stuff is blue or white or earth tones.
Green.
I have a nice green. And I make all the glazes. They're all food safe. Very concerned about that. I've been eating off my pottery for a long time. It hasn't done much to me. So.
We have been too.
So
very much.
No, but I mix the chemicals in my shop and everything. So, and they're earth chemicals, things like dolomite and silica and stuff like that.
So it's natural.
They're natural, but doesn't necessarily mean they're good. Like
coal
dust is natural.
Well,
but you don't want to breathe it. So
but people get confused by that today. But the labeling using natural versus it's not.
I mean, you can certainly put things in there that you wouldn't want to, but like traditional, some traditional areas, not stoneware, not anybody I know uses, will use a lead as the flux. And what that does, it helps melt the clay. Mm-hmm. So this is fired at a real high temperature. This is fired at 2300 degrees. Mm-hmm. Steel's what, 26, 28? Which for melting. And so at that temperature, any metals that would be in there are
just
long gone up the stack. So these are fuel fired. Both of these are fuel fired. I use a propane to fire my kiln. I also have an electric kiln, but I use both interchangeably. But the effects are slightly different on these.
Now you have two types here between the cup and the pitcher.
In what way?
Well, the cup is shiny. And
right.
Don't have the specks like the pitcher does.
Ah. Well, the specks are in the clay. So, like, this has specks in the side here and on here. And so, I don't know how I did this, but mentally, I'm like, I got to put specks in the clay, in the glaze. And I'm like, look, I know you bought clay with that specks in it. But traditionally, what happens is you have a stoneware clay, which would be, you would see yellow furnace bricks made out of that in this area. Or fireplace bricks. And if you fire that in an oxygen-free or oxygen-reduced atmosphere, the iron begins to come out and makes these speckles. So all the speckles are little spots of iron.
Okay.
So people over the years have found that that's pleasing, and so they make sure there's enough iron in there that it comes out. If it's not fired in a oxygen-reduced atmosphere, they don't really come out.
Okay.
They look like pepper. These have actually come out. They look more like freckles, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's one. So this one is just a white glaze underneath, and then there's blue on top of it, and it's actually the same blue that's on this. This is almost black, but it is a blue. And the top of it is an ash glaze, and it kind of drips down here. And both of these... don't have as much clay content as the white, so the more clay content, the more likely it is to be not shiny.
Yeah.
So, and you can adjust all that. Some people sometimes you'll get a bowl that makes a funny noise when you put the spoon in it, or some of the white glazes that are matte will spoon mark or knife mark, and so you don't want that either. So the shiny glazes don't do that as readily.
Mm-hmm.
You can see on the bottom, this is a white clay body, and it's not a porcelain, it just happens to be white clay. And there's no speckles in this. where this one has a lot of iron in it, and this has speckles and iron in it. So
it's sort of like more of the old world pottery, yeah, or jugs, or because we have a lot of that old.
Yeah, well, traditionally, like in this area, you'll find stoneware jugs that are gray,
yeah,
and they really not, they're not really gray. What it is there's a clear glaze on that, mm-hmm, and that's usually a salt glaze, is that clear glaze, when they'll have blue flourishes on them someplace, and then when you fire it in a reduced oxygen atmosphere, the iron raises the surface and combines with the clear glaze, and you get the gray color.
Okay.
So you'll see that sometimes. And I use that to effect here. So there is a gray component in this, but it's, if you see these stuff in person, you'll see that some of the white clay looks a little, it's a pleasant gray,
yeah,
you know. It's a warm, rich gray. And if I put it in the electric kiln, it's just white, it's just clear.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks nice either way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So you can use that to your advantage. And then this glaze is overlaid here. I know you can't. I don't know if you can see this, but there's a difference in this middle stripe here for this blue. And you can see inside; it's just white. It's white with a gray top. So I basically dipped it. I'm mostly interested in form. I don't like to draw, or I can't draw, depending on who you talk to. So I'm interested in the form, and I'm very interested in how the pieces feel in my hand.
Well, this is one thing that Steve does.
He has a little thumb holder.
It's
a secret.
And this. And when you're drinking.
Not anymore.
Steve, you're drinking too much. This spot here.
You put your thumb there.
Your thumb's on it, excuse me. But the thing of it is, this is something you would not buy on Amazon. For the simple fact is, we have mugs. And I know what my mug is, and if it's the same color from Judy's mug, I can't get my little finger in. And I like a mug to hold, where Judy's is smaller than I'm trying to get my fingers in, and then I'm spilling coffee all over the place. So
these are not for sale, by the way.
I know they're not, but the thing of it is, it's all of our work.
It's comfy.
You have to see it. You have to touch it.
Yeah. It's designed for you to touch. And the balance of the piece is real critical for me. I've been doing this for a long time. And sometimes you pick up a really pretty mug and it just feels horrible in your hand. Uh-huh. And I want something that I can sit there with my eyes closed by the fireplace and enjoy the feel of it. It's all about the feel. And if they would sell well, just glazed, a solid one color, I think I would probably do that, because the most important thing is me is just
the form.
And I make all kinds of things, like at the show, which is funny, you were talking about this earlier, but people ask me if I can make this or make that, mm-hmm, and you know, I've made the most unusual things for people. I completed an order, somebody wanted pigeon nesting bowls.
What?
Pigeon nesting bowls, like for pigeons, like really? Racing pigeons. I'm like, sure. Who knew they needed nesting bowls?
Yeah.
But I made some, and they were very happy with them. So people always ask me for unusual things. I've made tiles for people's roofs, and I've made bricks. And,
you also make dinner place settings.
I make a lot of anything that's round, you know. Yeah. So it's mostly cookware, but any, you know, bowls and berry bowls and casserole dishes. A lot of things have lids on them. And I do like the lids and flourishes and handles, because I think that takes your work to another level. And I think that's what you'll see when you see other ceramic craftsmen that are really successful. Mm-hmm. They've taken and they've come up with an elegant solution for handles, and it's a unique handle, and it's functional and it works.
Yeah.
And then there's little attentions to detail that are all over the thing, so that there's no part of the, and we all do this, there's mm-hmm. no part of our products that are not thought about.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can always say, you can pick it up and say, well, there's not some nasty mark on the bottom. He smoothed it off. He wrote his name on there. I date most of my pieces. Mm-hmm. I believe I date all my pieces, but mm-hmm. that's not always the case. But So that's what we do. So,
and it was a great science lesson tonight.
Yes, it was.
Well, I would talk about all this. I mean, I just like anything, like I find it fascinating to go watch other people. I would watch other people do pottery on vacation, and mm-hmm. I would go dig clay or read about it or look at museums. And the first thing potters will do is pick up somebody else's pottery.
Sure.
So I was recently in Utah, and I went to visit a potter and bought a piece of pottery. So
Very cool.
Were you on your motorcycle when you got
it? I was on the motorcycle, and I packed it up and brought it home. I drove it all the way across country in the motorcycle, on the motorcycle, and it survived very well.
Okay. So. Well, we'll come back to you probably later.
Okay.
We're going to move
thank
on
you,
to...
Steve.
Yeah, thank you, Steve.
You're welcome.
On to Judy, and you can explain your work, which is actually in the front of the table.
Okay. I'm a pressed flower artist. And it's interesting, I was working on a piece the other week when we were at the grandkids. Okay. And when my grandson came home, he said, what are you doing? He said, I'm making a picture using flowers. He said, oh, so you're taking flowers to make flowers.
Bingo.
I was pretty smart, and that's exactly what I do. I take flowers and I turn them into pieces of artwork. And what I brought tonight, I've been on here many times showing my cut work ability, but you had said about simplicity.
Mm-hmm. And I saw you walk in with it.
And there is nothing more simplified than a weed. This is Queen Anne's lace.
My favorite flower.
Which is a weed. And I just think it's beautiful. I've done one before, and I called it the Queen, and I sold it. So now this is my second piece that I've done, and I think I'll call this one QE2. I'm not sure yet. But what I did with this one, it doesn't show up on here, but there again, coming to the show, you'll be able to see it. I did add sparkles to all the Queen Anne's lace. I used glue, a spray glue, and then I have diamond dust that I put on it, and it gives it a little bit of a shine to it, something a little bit different. I do a lot, I've been doing a lot with whole flowers besides my cut work, and just every day you're trying to reinvent yourself, and that's what another thing that we're all about.
Well, the interesting thing about Queen Anne lace, and a lot of people probably don't know, it was actually brought over from Germany because it gets a red small little dot in the middle, and that is a very powerful dye. So Germans used it to dye red for red material.
Okay.
And each little teeny bracket on those flowers, you don't see it when you drive past it, but we have blown up, and each of those teeny specks have five petals around it. It is an amazing piece of vegetation, so to speak.
And I also learned...
It's just fascinating.
Somebody told me Queen Anne's lace, if it's a true Queen Anne's lace and it's not broken at all, if you count around the outside, there's 12 main points.
12 main points.
And the center is red.
Which is...
The blood of Christ and the 12 disciples around the outside.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Isn't
somebody had told me that also. So
the red is located in
the very center.
Now, the only thing is when I press them, that usually dries up and falls off.
Right. That's not very big in the center of that.
No, it's real.
It's just a tiny dot.
Yes. A tiny dot.
Yes. Now, have you ever taken, I mean, have you ever, like, gotten the dye
out? To try and dye? No.
I just wondered. I mean, how much would you need to, you know, I mean,
it's
so concentrated.
Yeah.
But
But it's really, and like I said, it's a weed.
You know, but that's a lovely story. I have to tell you, you've probably done this, Judy, because you do so much and with dried flowers. I dried those. One of my friends at church, and we gathered them last year, you know, went out, you know, in the height of Queen Anne's lace dye.
And we they mow it over.
And we dried them. And we put them on our Christmas tree.
Oh, yeah. Yes. You know, looks like
we have
crocheted.
That she does that every year.
Yeah. Beautiful. Well, actually, we've saved them from last year's. I mean, they're still
nice.
You can
still use them.
You know, So they would last a few years, I'm sure.
Now, one thing I did this year, and I just took them out of the presses last week, because it takes about 3 weeks for flowers to press.
Fully dry.
Right.
I dyed some blue.
Oh, okay.
You know, like we did when we were kids.
Sure, with the
you put them
in the water,
and put food coloring in. Okay. So I have blue ones. So I want to do a piece with the blue. So you'll see that after.
Now, did you dye them fresh before you pressed them?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. They have to.
We
be
dyed them fresh.
Right. You'd have to.
The yellow didn't change a whole lot.
Okay.
But the blue got beautiful, I'm anxious to do a piece with the blue. Yeah. And like I said, that'll be at the show.
Yeah,
I'll have those at the show.
And that was a nice story to share about, you know, the Jesus.
Yeah, the Jesus and the disciples.
I just thought that was interesting when somebody told.
Yeah, I did.
Then we stood there and looked. She said, "See," and she counted it.
Yeah.
And,
well, the fascinating thing about it, that is totally all glued down and it's also sealed. So it will not change its pH factor of the material.
And what's the backing that you use?
Now, that is a Japanese watercolor paper. And what I did with this, so it doesn't distract from the piece, I used the backside of the paper. Normally, the other side, it has
gold
or silver running through it, like muddled colors running through it.
So you didn't want it to
But I didn't
compete.
Want that to distract
it
from the
like
Queen
fabric.
Anne's legs.
So
it does.
It looks like fabric.
Yeah, it's
now
a paper.
It looks
it's
like,
kind of like a textured
now
paper.
Now it looks like fabric.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought when you brought it.
It's kind of a textured paper,
when you brought
yes.
it in. Like you said, always reinventing yourself, or you just, you know.
I used it when I first started. I just did them, my pieces, on cardstock.
Mm-hmm.
Well, then I started using rice paper, and I have the Japanese watercolor paper. And it just adds a whole nother dimension to the work that I do.
Yeah. And the key word is dimension, because it gives it, you know,
it does.
Depth
and it does.
Longevity, you know.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's encased in glass and sealed in the back as
this
well.
Yeah, this doesn't have the glass on yet, but it was good. That way it shows up.
Shows up,
for the
yeah, you wouldn't get the glare from tonight.
So
awesome. Okay.
So
we'll let this guy talk for a couple minutes.
Yeah.
I know.
We'll
go back. Just a few minutes.
If you didn't know, this is Terry.
Hello.
This is Judy's husband.
Hello, folks. How are you doing today? Here we go. So, anyways.
What do you do, Terry?
I recreate stone and log houses in miniature form with reclaimed wood.
Okay.
Most of my wood. This house, the two-story part, that is done to represent stone. I carve into the wood to have it pop out and make it look like I didn't paint the back of this.
Now, is this wood old too?
No.
No, this is not.
That has to be new wood.
Okay.
That's, because I can carve in saw cut plastilath, and I can carve.
I figured that
the wood that I used for the side house. Mm-hmm. I'll move it over for the camera.
Mm-hmm.
The summer kitchen is my oldest wood. This is from approximately 1685.
Wow.
And it's actually from Richard Penn's manor, but it was a family that lived there prior to the Penn family. They were coming from the northwest. And the thing is, I did this way, and I put the little summer kitchen in with this because this actually was at two locations on Route 183, and both of them are now torn down.
Oh,
the one, the total thing's torn down, and the other one, they tore the summer kitchen off. Why, I do not know. So, but needless to say, no, this is not wood from that those houses. But I recreate them to, and they're half inch scale to a foot. And I use house spackling for the white. I've been doing this since 1991, and all my originals are perfectly intact, and that's because of the construction of it. There's an interior panel, wood goes vertical, and the outside is horizontal, so it cannot expand or contract with glue and nails. And the roofing material is actually what I still have is from the back of a barn in Upper Burn Township. And they had like five layers on top of the roof, the wooden shingles. So that's what I'm using here. So this is I have not done double houses before. So I just
suggested
it. Because then I had these two houses, and it's like it's heartbreaking for them to see them tear it down. But every time you see a summer kitchen, that was the original house. So I do another building where I have the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost come out, and that was also the original homestead of the property as well. And we have very old homesteads in Berks County, especially west of Route 61, all the way out to the Lehigh Line.
Yeah.
That
as long
is really
they don't
the
tear
old
them down.
Yeah, they don't even know they're logged, to tell you the truth.
Oh, well, a lot of times they
a lot of times they
right.
don't because they're covered up.
Because they covered them
they
up,
cover them
you know. With
So this is a new piece for this year that I have.
Yeah, it's very nice.
So I'll let you look at that for a while.
One question. Now, like when you, you know, someone purchases this, do they get a history on the house?
Yeah, I put the information on the bottom.
On the bottom.
And the house is numbered, and I try, especially if I know where the house is located.
I give them that information.
Yeah. It's fully documented. Mm-hmm. And that's what I like, the genealogy part of it, and the homesteader, mm-hmm. because I do have researched many, many houses back into, and actually in Bethel Township in Berks County had really old ones because the Penn family thought there were a lot of squatters on their land. Mm-hmm. And they were squatters coming out of New York down the Susquehanna and up the Sitara Creek Basin and came into northwestern Berks County. And that was settled way before the Penn family was even in the picture.
Yeah,
because the French were there too. Mm-hmm. So, henceforth the French in the war. And then the Penn family went to Philadelphia and never came back.
So just think about this. You come to one of these guild shows, okay, to the specific one I'm going to talk about, November 3rd and 4th,
yeah, you can't 69th forget about
that. Annual Holiday Fine Arts and Crafts Festival. You get a history lesson. You get a science lesson. You get an art lesson.
Construction lesson.
Woodshop.
Use credit cards wherever you think. You might not ever use a credit card.
You know, so, I mean, seriously.
Turn artwork into the puzzling The thing of it is mind-boggling, but for a person coming in there, and it's just a treasure trove of, and you will spend the whole day if you're really doing it right.
Yeah. And one thing, spending the whole day with our cafe being right in the same room as the show.
Yeah. You take a break.
You can go through the aisles. Yeah. Oh, I'm hungry. Let's get something to eat. You sit down, and then you decide, oh, well, I want to go back into that booth, and I want to go to that booth. Mm-hmm. So you have time to spend the whole day and not have to worry. And while you're eating, you enjoy the music, and you do your thinking, and continue shopping.
You
can, you know, most of us, Terry, as you know, are jewelry master craftspeople.
Yes.
So we all have depth in our fields.
That's true.
So if you want to come and find out about anything, well, first stop at my booth. But
you will, because he's in
the
first aisle.
I mean, we just love to tell you about it. We all are really in depth, whether it's, you know, wood species or artwork or anything. We just love to talk about what we do. So
because we know we know the bottom line of it. We know the history.
Right.
And we know the makings, and a lot of people don't do that and don't know that.
And we're at the height of the holiday shopping
season.
You know, first weekend in November.
Cleon's across from us, and he's busy, and his wife's busy with. But anyways, and I wanted to say, with Cleon's work, his workmanship in the wood is the fantastic part. He just attaches it to utensils to make it a functional piece. Mm-hmm. Right. And one thing that Cleon does, and anybody with fat fingers like me, I like to have a pen, and he puts a knob on the end so my fingers don't slide off the pen or the pen fly out the back.
Yeah.
So there's always something in our works that
makes it special and personal.
So, you know, the thing of it is, look, we have a lot of rack cards out, and we'll be mailing cards.
Oh, they'll be getting the mailing.
And
we're going to be on TV.
Yeah, I wanted to show you this. This happens to be Debbie Jarrett's new piece for the season. And she is a two-dimensional and a three-dimensional artist.
Folk art.
And it's sawdust.
It's fabric.
But
she
it's stuffed,
paints on it, and the inside of it is sawdust.
Correct. Okay. And the thing of it is, it's another artist that is humongous, amazing, you cannot imagine. But the thing of it is, what I'm getting at is, we'll be having, there's some people that say they're putting applications in yet, but we have about 75 artists.
Okay.
And that is November 3rd and 4th. And the thing of it is, remember, also, you forgot one thing, and I'll remind you, the first 50 coming in the door,
go ahead,
get a special price for the holidays on both Saturday and Sunday. And one of our artists,
Martifo.
Yeah, Butcher will have the gun metal.
He's the metal artist.
The metal artist that I couldn't remember before. Mm-hmm. And there'll be additional stuff available in the bag also.
Okay. And there's also, we have our pick a prize.
Oh, yeah, I didn't.
Okay, we have that.
We have a pick a prize, which you can.
We have hourly door prizes.
Door prizes as well.
And we did talk about the student gout. I mean, there is so much to talk about, you know.
Scavenger hunt?
Are we having a scavenger hunt?
I don't know. We didn't talk about it.
We didn't talk about that. Last year we had a scavenger hunt. Really great. It worked out fine.
Yes.
Well, you check at the door.
Yes, you check at the
door. Check at the door, and it'll be at the door.
Okay. But we have these other things.
We have rugs.
We have Penny rugs. We have Shirin Schnitta. We have calligraphy.
Baskets.
We have basketry. Jewelry. Okay. And potters. And we have weaving.
A lot of fabric.
Photography. We have some fantastic photographers. Wearable
leather,
art.
Leather.
We have block
paper
printing.
Paper mache. Chalkware.
Quilting. Furniture. Leather.
Aluminumware.
Aluminum.
Utensils.
We do. Paper mache.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Chalkware.
I did say that.
Okay. We have
Frothers.
So much stuff.
You can do all your Christmas shopping at one place.
Yeah, that's right. Santa does.
Yeah.
We suggested it to him a couple years ago.
First.
Yeah. So, you know, it's a Saturday and a Sunday. And actually, I think all sports for small kids are finished by then.
And if they're not, you
if
just
not, come anyways.
Go and to the game and then come right over.
Because I know we have grandkids that have games. Yes, but we're open from
9 o'clock
to 5,
Saturday
till 4.
5 till 5 on Saturday.
Your clock's back too, so you get an extra hour to shoot.
Oh,
thank
Diana.
You. My goodness, you get an extra hour.
Is that that weekend?
Yeah,
that's Saturday.
Yeah, it's
my
so
goodness.
And then young
hour.
Children are not charged for the door.
Oh, right. Or that is true.
12 and under, it's free.
Children 12 and under are free. And
if you get one of our rack carts, postcards, or even in the
go paper, to our website
or the internet,
go to our website,
Facebook,
too. Find us RBC
and
rbcrafts.org,
rbcrafts.org, and there is a discount coupon in there as well.
We're going to be on TV. We have some commercials coming up on TV, so
and we'll be at the auction next week.
We're going to be at the auction.
Oktoberfest.
Thursday of Oktoberfest,
yes.
Is. Your Berks
Craftsmen. Yes. Well, they're helping out that night. It's on Thursday night. It's the art and craft that
yes.
night. You know, the
which
Thursday night art night.
It's the night to be on BCTV.
Oh, yeah. Well, every night that week. But, you know, there is something for everyone. So you got to support BCTV Oktoberfest. They support us. We support them. So, okay, guys, we did a great show
yay.
Here tonight.
Yeah.
All we can say is come on out and see us November 3rd and 4th. And
thank you guys for all coming.
Yeah,
thank
really.
You for having us. Thank you.
Well, thanks for buying dinner.
Okay.
Oh, you're welcome. Okay. I just gave it to BCTV. They'll pay for it.
Okay. And I want to thank our viewing audience tonight. We're just going to say good night.
Bye.
Your Berks Craftsman on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Reading Berks Guild of Craftsmen. BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.